rejected by God?
No.
No. Because the only thing on our account is his righteousness. Now, let me read this with me if you could. Therefore, because of Christ, I am what?
Totally
accepted by God. I no longer have to feel what? Come on, say this again now. Therefore, because, let's say it together. Therefore, because of Christ, I am totally accepted by God. I no longer have to fear rejection. Come on, one more time. Therefore, because of, hallelujah, Christ, I am totally accepted by God. I no longer have to fear rejection. Now this right here, if you can see this, read this with me. I am fully accepted by God in Christ. Come on, one more time. I am fully accepted by God in Christ. One more time. I am fully accepted by God in Christ. You know God deserves another hand clap of praise. Fully accepted, fully accepted, fully accepted. And our challenge is, we're so used to being around fickle people.
Yes.
That whenever we do something wrong, they don't want to be around us anymore. And as a result, we think that God is like that. So if some folk, people jump through all these hoops trying to please folk. And people can never be pleased.
Amen.
They can't be. They want one thing on Friday, want one of theirs on Monday. You go through all these changes. And these sisters, all y'all going through all these hairstyles and eye color. At some point, the brother got to accept you as you are, big hips and all, or he's not going to accept you at all. Let me try to jump through all these hoops trying to get somebody to accept you. But God says that at this point, I've accepted you just like you are.
Amen.
You don't have to change a thing. You don't have to. I accept you with no eyelashes or fake eyelashes. I'd accept with your own hair or with weed. I would accept you in the way you are because you are now fully, glory to God, fully accepted by God. And the challenge is so many people have lived lives being rejected. It's hard to embrace the fact we've been accepted by God. Been rejected by parents and rejected by friends and rejected by family and rejected by other folk. And at this point, it is hard to embrace the fact that I serve a God who loves me so much that because of what Jesus did, all I got to do is believe, and now I'm fully accepted by God in Christ. Now this is the slide right here. This is where the admission price. Read this right here. Let's read this together. I'm accepted by God, and it has nothing. I'll tell you, you get hold of that. Come on again. I am accepted by God, and it has nothing to do with me. One more time. I'm accepted by God, and it has nothing to do with me. It has to do with what Christ did, and I receive what Christ did. It's not based on my behavior. It's not based on my action. It's not based on what I did. It's not based on where I've been. It's not based on who I've been with. It is based on what Jesus did on the cross. I have now been accepted by God. And it has nothing to do with me. Righteousness. What does it mean again? Made acceptable to God. Brought into a right standing with him. So how can we now then see ourselves as God sees us? How? Through the blood and the cross of Jesus. Before the cross, it was all about our behavior. After the cross, it's all about our belief. Many of us know the verse very well in Deuteronomy 28. Blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when you come, blessed when you go, all these other things. But then we don't want to go back down to Deuteronomy 28, verse 30. It says, cursed shall you be if you don't do what God called you to do. So in the Old Testament, if you did bad, you got bad. You did good, you got good. Now under grace, now under here, God says, I'm going to love you in spite of you. I'm going to accept you when everybody else has rejected you. I have accepted you. You are righteous, not based on your behavior, but the fact that you have believed correctly according to the word. So here's the last question. Are believers righteous regardless of what they do?
Yes.
Are believers righteous regardless of what they do?
Yes.
Are believers righteous regardless of what they do?
Yes.
Why? Because when God looks at us, what's on our account? Oh, let me have to go back and do this again. I will in a heartbeat. The idea, when God looks at the ledger and the account of our lives, what does he see? Does he see? What does he see?
Righteousness.
righteousness. He cannot see sin because all the sin has been put on Jesus' account. And even though we, so here's the point. So then people say, well, you know what? Should I keep on sinning? No, 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 no. Don't sin more. We gonna sin less because somebody was willing to pay the cost for us. If you got debt on the credit card and somebody comes by and pays it off, it's for most rational people not going to want to get into more debt. Just so glad, hallelujah, I don't want to see a credit card. And somebody was getting good enough to pay it off, we don't want to get in any more debt. Same thing with sin. We just so grateful. Our sins are no longer on our account. Just so grateful. Our failures are not on our account. Just so grateful. Our slips are not on our account. They are now on the account of Jesus. And now when we start recognizing we are right, and we are righteous, we're going to start doing righteous.
Amen.
The folks that believers can still do unrighteous things. But the more we realize we've been accepted by God, the more we realize we are the righteous of God, after a while, the things we used to do, not going to want to do them anymore because we've been accepted by God. Many times folk are doing stuff just to be accepted. Many times folk are doing things just to feel like they're part of. But when we know that we are unconditionally accepted by God and righteous before His sight, we're not going to sin more. We sin less because the sin is on whose account?
Jesus.
On Jesus' account. Please give God one more hand clap of praise right here, Lord. So our acceptance and our righteousness are not based on our behavior, but based on our belief. So this whole year, we've been sharing this whole year is extraordinary living, sing. In 2010. Anybody ready to start living an extraordinary life? I mean, really, an extraordinary life. And for so long, we've just been getting by and doing mediocre lives. God gave us His best, and this celebration of Resurrection Sunday is an invitation to realize that we now can live extraordinary lives. Please read with me, either side you can look at. Read with us up here as well, either side, the same thing, same words. Ordinary people become extraordinary. How?
Trusting
in our extraordinary God. Do it, read again. Ordinary folks, just like us, become what? Extraordinary. How? Trusting in our extraordinary God. One more time. Ordinary people become extraordinary. How? Trusting in our extraordinary God. If you are ready to embrace that you are extraordinary, would you please join me in giving God a hand of praise in Jesus' name? So when we realize that we're extraordinary, our sub-theme is embracing and enjoying life.
Yes.
It's time for some believers to start enjoying life.
Amen.
Now, I'm not seeing the challenge is we've only seen enjoyment from the world and not enjoyment from the Word.
Yes.
And here's the other thing. Sometimes many of us have been to some Christian events. It's just so boring, like, oh, Lord, I'm not coming back here again. Now, there'll be some enjoyment. See, enjoying life says that at this point, because we've been following what God has called us to do, that when we hear a police siren go down Pinecroft, we know it's not us. Glory to God.
Amen.
Enjoying life is can go to bed at night and not worrying and not fretting and not all working, not doubting. Because I know the same God that brought me to it is the same God that'll bring me through it. That's embracing. Embracing and enjoying life says, I don't care what you did. I don't care what you said. I'm going to love you anyway. And there's nothing you can do about it. What about going to tap in? That is embracing and enjoying life. Says, I don't have to walk around with all this weight and all of this doubt and all of these sins and all of these shortcomings, because now all those things have been credited to Jesus' account and no longer on my account. So now, ordinary, if you can read this with me, please. Extraordinary, what? The life you are meant to live. God formed you. God created you. God chose you to live an extraordinary life. It is time for believers to stop accepting mediocrity.
Amen.
It is time for believers to stop trying to be average. Glory. It's time for believers to say, no longer am I ordinary. I am extraordinary because I trust and believe and rely on an extraordinary God. Now, that has been said from Matthew chapter 28. From the now you can now ready to preach. So from Matthew chapter 28, Matthew 28. If you would turn with me there just for a moment, Matthew 28, I want to look at a couple of verses here before we end our time together. And on your bulletin, you should have the word written down, accepted. I'm going to give us one or two A's, one C, and then we'll pick up the rest of that on our Tuesday Bible study and then the rest of this month as well. So Matthew chapter 28, although it's verses 1 through 20 from the Amplified Classic, we're going to read just only verses 5 through 7 from the King James Version, and I'll reference the Amplified Classic Version in just a moment. Won't you repeat after me? I am ready to receive the word.
I'm excited
about receiving the word.
I'm prepared to receive the word.
Won't you stand even now in the presence of the Lord as we read Matthew 28, verses 5 through 7 together from the King James Version, although our teaching comes from the Amplified Classic Version. Matthew 28, this is the resurrection here. Let's read that beginning in verse 5. And the angel answered and said unto the woman, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he saith. Come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, I go before you into Galilee. There ye shall see him. Lo, I have told you. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to just kind of share a couple of points here in our scripture. I will tell you what our A's are going to be, and then let me go and give you what the C is going to be. Don't write down this one C because we may not get to spend a lot of time there. This first C is simply crucified. I want to talk about that. It is impossible to have a crucifixion if there is not first. It's impossible to have a resurrection if there's not first a crucifixion.
Yes.
Something has to die,
yes,
in order for life to occur.
Yes.
So at this point, Resurrection Sunday is not possible without Good Friday's crucifixion. So crucifixion. But I got two A's I want to share with us here in particular, two A's. The first A we want to have, here, if you write that down from verse 10, both of these are coming from the Amplified Classic Version, And tell my brethren to go into Galilee. Now, I want you to think about what's happening here. That the disciples are nowhere to be found. The disciples are now scattered after Jesus has been crucified. Women make their way to the tomb at this point, and as they are there, they encounter this angel, and the stone has been removed, and the angel said, he is not here. He is risen. He's gone into Galilee. So now, go and tell my brethren, go to Galilee. Verse 10 right here, it's King James as well, but also Amplified. So here's a question I have for you. Have you ever thought about, now think about this, out of all the places they could go, why would they go to Galilee? Why go tell my brethren? The last time they were all together, they saw Jesus being crucified. They saw their leader being destroyed. They are wondering if the same people who had Jesus on the cross are going to come for us. So the next time they get together, the angel says, go and meet in Galilee. So the question is, why Galilee? Why, of all the places that Jesus went over 3 years, why Galilee? Well, let's take a look at this. Galilee, first of all, means to roll over, or it means to give over, to roll or to give over. So you think about the symbolism here is if you ever carry a weight, suppose you got all these groceries and somebody comes and takes that weight from you. That's what Galilee means, to give over, to roll over. You got all this weight going on and now you got all this extra baggage and somebody now comes and takes that from you. That's what Galilee means, to roll over, to roll, or to give over. So the question is, why Galilee? Let me tell you at least, I'm going to tell you a couple things that happened in Galilee and why.